हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम बैक। माई सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर डेली करंट अफेयर्स। सो टुडे यू हैव 8th of July 2021 एंड एज यू नो दैट दिस लेक्चर्स आर यूजफुल फॉर दोज हु आर प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर द सिविल सर्विसेज एग्जामिनेशन विच इज कंडक्टेड बाई द UPSC एंड फॉर दैट पर्पज यू मस्ट रीड द टू नेशनल न्यूज पेपर्स, द हिंदू और इंडियन एक्सप्रेस। वी आर ऑल्सो रेफरिंग दिस टू नेशनल न्यूज पेपर्स फॉर अवर करंट अफेयर्स लेक्चर्स एंड यू कैन सप्लीमेंट योर प्रिपरेशन विद द हेल्प ऑफ दीज लेक्चर्स। सो लेट्स बिगिन विद द लेक्चर। So first news is all about the anti-methanogenic feed supplement that have been named as Harit Dhara. So Indian Council of Agricultural Research, right, which is an institute, right, have developed this anti-methanogenic feed supplement which is named as Harit Dhara, right. So what is anti-methanogenic feed supplement? Okay. So first of all, the Harit Dhara, which have been named as the feed supplement, it is being used, right, or it has been prepared using some sort of a tannin-rich plant-based sources, right. This tannin-rich plant-based resources are basically abundantly available in our country, in our tropical country like India, right. This plant-based resources are basically condensed and hydrolyzable, right, and then we prepare this type of anti-methanogenic feed supplement. So what we do basically in that condensation process or in the formation of this anti-methanogenic feed supplement, so it basically changes the composition of the volatile fatty acids, right, which are basically the end results of the rumen fermentation along with the hydrogen and carbon dioxide. So what happens is, you know, this Harit Dhara, which have been used or which will be used in our country as an anti-methanogenic feed supplement, would roughly cost, you know, to the farmers or to the users of around 6 rupees per kg, right. And as it is basically a feed supplement, that means it will be used as a supplementary feed to the animals, right, to the animals like you have, you know, like, you know, bovine animals, like you have cow, buffaloes and etc. So it can be used to a feed supplement. So it will be cheaper, around 6 rupees per kg, and it can only be feed to the animals that are aged above a 3 months. There is some limitation with that, okay. And those animals which are having the fully functional, you know, the rumen for that purpose. And when this feed supplement is given to the bovines or the sheep specifically, right, it should not be cut down, right, or, you know, it will cut down, you know, some sort of a methane emissions by around 17 to 20%. So the most important aspect of this feed supplement is that it is anti-methanogenic. That means it will cut down the methane emissions, cut down the methane emissions by around 17 to 20%, and it will also results in the higher milk production as well as the higher body weight gain, right. As you have, you know, the milk industries, right, the flesh industries or, you know, the meat industries. So the body weight gain is also one of the important aspect of this anti-methanogenic feed supplement to the animals, specifically to the bovines and to the sheep. Now, what is the significance of this anti-methanogenic, you know, food supplement? So first of all, it will be used, right, for feeding of various cattle, right, buffaloes, sheep and goats, right, which are estimated to around, you know, emitting 9.25 million tons to around 14.2 million tons of methane annually, right. And this is basically one of the greatest contribution that was made by the cattle industry or by the bovine industry or animal rearing industry in our country. Though it is not organized, but still around 10 to 14 million tons of the methane that have been released, okay, through that process. And that is around around out of 19 million tons plus, you know, from the livestock. So, you know, the given methane global warming potential, that is around 25 times of the carbon dioxide. So that is called, you know, the global warming potential, right? That is the potential of, you know, your nitrogen dioxide or nitrous oxide to, you know, to warm your environment. That is around 25 times the carbon dioxide over 100 years, right? It is a most potent greenhouse gas. So the nitrogen, which is also one of the important component of this nitrous oxide, is one of the most potent greenhouse gases. You know, an average lactating cow, that is, or lactating buffalo in India, emits around 200 liters of methane that has been released annually, right, that has been released naturally per day. So around 200 liters of the methane is released, and you know, a young growing adult sheep is also, you know, release around 20 to 25 liters of the methane per day. So that is a huge contribution from the lactating sheep, lactating cow, and lactating your bovine animals. So if you use this anti, this type of, you know, the feed which is anti-methanogenic, which will basically cut down this type of methane emissions from these lactating animals. So feeding Haridhara can reduce these by almost 1/5. So that is given by Indian Council of, you know, Agriculture Research, that if you feed this Haridhara, the reduction of the nitrogen content or reduction of this nitrogen from these lactating animals will be cut down by almost 1/5. Okay. Now, one thing that is coming to your mind, that how the methane is produced by the cattles. So first of all, the methane is produced by the animals which is having the rumen, right? So here, you know, in their stomach, where the plant material they eat, right, in their normal digestion process, which consisting of the cellulose, fibers, starch, sugars, right? These plant materials, which basically fermented or broken down into small particles by the microorganism, okay, prior to further digestion and the nutrient uptake or absorption in the abdomen itself. So here the carbohydrate fermentation, which is basically fermentation of the carbohydrates rich food like cellulose, fiber rich, or all sort of food, leads to the production of the carbon dioxide and the hydrogen in that process, right? These are basically used as a substrate by an archaea, which is a microbe, okay, in the rumen, which is having the similar structures as like a bacteria, to produce the methane. So that type of, you know, the production of carbon dioxide and hydrogen that has been used by this bacteria, which is known as the archaea, which is basically used, right, you know, to produce the methane, which the animals then expel through, you know, burping process. Okay, this Haridhara act as, you know, decreasing the population of the protozoa microbes in the rumen itself, right, which basically convert this thing into the nitrogen, and which is responsible for the hydrogen production, okay, and making it available to the archaea for the reduction of the carbon dioxide to the methane in that process. So here you will have the reduction to the carbon dioxide to the methane through this, you know, the microbe called archaea in that process. So this Haridhara would definitely cut down the reduction of carbon dioxide into methane. So tropical plants which are containing the tannins, right, specifically which are the chemical compounds, you know, are known to suppress this protozoa from the rumen. So you have the tropical country like India, the tropical plants which are rich in terms of the cellulose, fiber, starch, also rich in terms of tannins. They are known for the reduction or the suppression of this basically, you know, this protozoa from the rumen. That is the most important aspect. Now in India it is very much needed. For example, if you see the 2019 livestock census, right, the India's cattle population is around 193 million, okay, and if you consider that 200 liters of the methane which is basically produced per day by a lactating cow or lactating buffalo, and the sheep itself is producing around 20 to 25 liters per day of nitrogen, you can assume that how much the 193 million, you know, the cattle will be producing. So that is the huge. In out of 193 million, you will have around 109 million buffaloes, okay, around 148 million goats, okay, and around 74.26 million sheep. So it's a very high, okay, very high population, you know, you have with respect to the livestock. So you have 193 million, you know, your cattle, you have buffaloes around 109 million buffaloes, 148 million you have the goats, and around 74 million you have sheep. Okay, so it's a very, very, you know, a huge population of the cattle, buffalo, you know, your goats and your sheep. If you use that type of anti-methanogenic, you know, the feed supplement, that would cut down the emission of the nitrogen from the stomach, right, of those animals, right, specifically the lactating animals. Okay, next. The discrete auroras on the marsh. So here the news is that the most important news is that the UAE Hope spacecraft, right, this Hope spacecraft, which is orbiting around the marsh, right, since February this year have captured the images of this growing atmospheric light, which have been shown in the red planet or on the marsh, which are known as the discrete aurora. So UAE's Hope spacecraft have taken the pictures specifically from the marsh of these discrete auroras from the marsh. So it's a very important, depiction shown by this Hope spacecraft in that process. So what is this discrete lightning, or what is that glowing in the atmosphere that has caused this discrete aurora, right, on the earth? So what is the reason specifically? So auroras are basically caused when you have the charged particles which are found in the ionosphere or in the exosphere, right, they are ejected from the sun surface, right, in the form of solar winds. As soon as these charged particles enters into the earth's surface, right, they basically interact with other elements in our atmosphere and causes this, you know, this aurora. So these particles are first of all are harmful, and our planet is basically protected by the geomagnetic field, which is basically produced by the earth itself, which preserves the life of the earth by shielding us from this harm, from this harmful solar winds. Okay, however, at the northern and the southern poles specifically, some of the solar winds particles are able to continuously stream down. Okay, and these solar winds or these charged particles, they basically interact, you know, with the gases. Specifically, I'm talking in terms of the northern pole and the southern pole, where they continue to descend, right, in that region. Okay, and they started interacting with the gases in the atmosphere to cause this display of the light in the night, in the sky, that is basically we call the aurora. Okay, and this display, which is known as aurora, is basically seen from the earth high latitude regions. Okay, only which are seen from the high latitude regions, you know, it can be seen or can be active all throughout the year. It cannot be seen, or it is rarely seen from the lower latitude regions. So if you move to the higher latitude regions, like 60-70 degrees, you know, 80 degree, you know, and the latitude, northern latitude, you will be finding this type of aurora or the display of these lights. Okay, now where are they observed on the earth? So it is very, very important that in the south, they are also known as the aurora australis, right? Easy to remember that Australia is basically there in the southern continent or in the southern hemisphere, right? So the name itself is named after the Australis, so it is aurora australis, right, in the name of Australia, just to remember yourself. Okay, these are also known as the southern lights, and they are also visible in the northern hemisphere, say nearby in the Antarctica, Chile, Argentina, North New Zealand and your Australia. Okay, now what we can say that in the northern part of our globe, okay, the polar lights are basically known as, you know, they are known as the aurora borealis, or they are known as the northern lights in the northern hemisphere. Okay, and if you see specifically in the southern hemisphere, they are known as aurora australis or the southern lights. If you find out this aurora borealis or the northern light, you can easily find out in the USA, specifically the Alaska, which is found in the higher latitudinal region, Canada, okay, Greenland, Norway, Sweden and Finland. These are the regions which are finding out at the higher latitudinal region where you can find out this aurora borealis. Okay, and in the southern hemisphere, I have already informed you. Okay, now the most important aspect is that how are this Martian aurora? Martian aurora means that aurora which have been depicted or which have been got by this, you know, by this probe at the Martian atmosphere, all right, specifically at the Mars surface, how it is different from this normal aurora. So here, unlike the auroras which have shown on the earth because of interaction of the solar winds or the charged particles on the gaseous particles on the basically the atmosphere, right, such type of Martian aurora are seen only near the north and the southern poles. Okay, and this discrete aurora which are found on the marsh are seen all around the planet at the night time. So this is the major difference, that in on the earth these auroras, aurora borealis or aurora australis, are only shown at the higher latitudes, and that too, you know, at the poles, at the northern poles and the southern poles. But in the Martian atmosphere, it has been shown all around the planet. Wherever you go, you can find out this Borealis or this aurora in the night time, specifically in the night time. And unlike Earth, which has the strong magnetic field, that is the geomagnetic field, the Martian magnetic field is largely died out, right? So it has very insignificant, you know, the magnetic field as you compare with the Earth. This is because, you know, the molten iron at the interior part of the planet, you know, produces this magnetism, have been cooled down, right? And because of that, the magnetic field is basically died down on the surface of Mars. But in the Martian crust, you know, the hardened, this magnetic field are still exist, right? But have some remains of this magnetism, but that is not comparable with the Earth magnetic field. So in the contrast with the Earth, you can say that, right, it can act like one single bar magnet, right? Or the magnetism on the Mars is unevenly distributed because of the cooling of this, you know, the iron which have been found in the deeper part of the Mars, okay, and which have been field, you know, across the planet in the different direction, the different strength, right? And this type of, you know, the solar winds, when they enter on the Martian surface, create some sort of a discrete auroras all over the entire surface of the planet, right? As they basically, you know, charge particles, and when they interact, right, with the surface or with the atmosphere of the Mars, definitely they produce this type of discrete light. And for these studies, they are very, very important, right? Because the studying of the Martian auroras is important because it can offer some clue about the red planet, why the red planet have lost its magnetic field, right? You know, and it was also having some sort of a thick atmosphere, right, which is also the most important requirement for the sustaining the life. But because of that, it has not got any sort of a life on the surface of the Mars. Okay, so that is basically a depiction of the Martian auroras on the surface of Mars. Okay, let us understand the Hope orbiter, which have depicted this Martian auroras. So what is the Hope probe? So Hope probe is the Arrow World's first mission to the Mars, that the Arrow World have sent to the surface of the Mars, that took off from the Earth in the July last year, that is July 2020. Okay, and it has been orbiting the red planet or the Mars since February, when it enters into the orbit of the Mars. The primary objective of the Hope orbiter is very, very simple: to study the Martian weather dynamics. Okay, and by correlating some sort of a lower atmosphere and the upper atmospheric conditions, you know, this probe would, you know, look into how the weather changes, you know, the escape of the hydrogen and oxygen into the space. Okay, and by measuring this, how much the hydrogen and oxygen is splitting into the space. So scientists will also look into why Mars lost so much of its early atmosphere in the liquid water. Okay, and it is expected from this Hope orbiter to make a first complete portrait of the planet's atmosphere. Okay, definitely, which will also try to understand the climate dynamics of the surface of the Martian atmosphere. Mars, as you know, it is the fourth planet from the Sun, okay, and is the second smallest planet in our solar system, right? That is the second planet that is only larger to the Mercury, right? You have the Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, that is in the ratio. So Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, so it's a fourth planet from the Sun, okay? And in English, the Mars carries the name that is in the name of Roman god of war, and it is also referred to the red planet, okay? And the red planet, which refers to the effect of the iron oxide which is prevalent on the Martian surface. Okay, so that iron oxide basically gives the reddish appearance. Okay, so that iron oxide gives reddish appearance, that is the distinctive among all astronomical bodies that are visible from the naked eye. So Mars is basically a terrestrial planet, that means it is basically looks like, you know, Earth like planet, a solid surface with a very thin atmosphere. Okay, and the surface features are basically, you know, having some sort of a craters, valleys, deserts, you know, some sort of a remnants are also being found over there. Okay, the days and the seasons you can compare with the Mars with the Earth, because you know, the rotational speed as well as the tilt of this rotational axis, you know, is very, very similar to that. So you can compare with that in that aspect. Okay. The next, the new online platform maps, PGSS Spread. Okay. So here, an online database that is about to use of the spyware PGSS was basically recently launched by Forensic Architecture, Amnesty International, and the Citizens Lab to document that attacks the human rights defenders. Right. So what was the PGSS? So in the last year, you might have seen or you might have seen the news that it was one of the biggest story related to the cyberspace. That was, you know, the WhatsApp also reports that around 1400 of its users were hacked by this PGSS. Okay, the PGSS was basically a spyware tool from the Israeli firm NSO Group that has been sent to get some data or confidential data from the users, specifically from the WhatsApp. Okay, and the PGSS or, you know, that spyware tool, you know, do not do what the name suggests. So they spy on the people throughout their phones, right? And the PGSS works, you know, by sending an exploit link to the users, right? And if the target users clicks on the link on the WhatsApp, okay, you know, a malware or some sort of a code which allow, you know, to enter into the device, and that basically started some sort of a surveillance, right, which is being installed in the user's phone through this WhatsApp. So it's a new version of the malware, you can say that, right, which does not even require a target user to click on the link, right? So the newer version can also be entered into that, and once this PGSS is installed, right, the attacker has the complete access to the target's user phone. So it is very, very crucial, you know, malware to snooping activities, to check into the user's activities, right? Why this PGSS is very, very dangerous? The PGSS is very, very dangerous, as you know that, as spares no aspect of the person's identity. It can disclose, it can have the total command on the person's identity, right? It makes the older technique of the spying seems relatively harmless, and it can intercept every call, every SMS, right, on the particular user. It can read every email, it can monitor every and each messaging app once it has been installed, right? And this PGSS can also control the phone's camera also, microphone also, and it can also access to the location's data, right, where the particular phone is located. So it's a very, very important that it's a malware, right, which has been originated from the Israel, that is from NSO Group. Okay. Next, the export of the geographically indication certified, you know, the Walia wheat. So, you know, it is the most important aspect that a major boost have been led to the export of the wheat, specifically from the geographically indicated, the Walia variety of wheat that have been exported to the Kenya and the Sri Lanka from the Gujarat. Okay, this Walia wheat is basically, you know, geographically indicated tagged. So what is the Walia wheat is all about? The Walia wheat is geographically indicated or geographically indicated certified wheat quality. It has got very high protein content, and it is also sweeter in the taste as compared to the other type of wheat. This Walia wheat or the variety of the wheat can be grown, right, in mostly all of the Bhel region of Gujarat, right? The Bhel region of the Gujarat consisting of Ahmedabad, Anand, Kheda, Bhavnagar, Suratnagar, and your Bharuch district of the Gujarat. Okay, the most important unique characteristic of the wheat variety is that it can be grown in the rain-fed condition. In the rain-fed condition, okay, that too without agriculture, without irrigation, sorry, that too the without irrigation, and it can be cultivated, right, around 2 lakh hectares of the agricultural land in the Gujarat, specifically in these districts. And this Walia varieties of the breed is basically received the geographical indication tag way back in 2011. In 2011, it has received, okay. And it is a very, very important that, you know, Anand Agriculture University was basically registered proprietor for this geographical indication for this variety of, you know, this type of wheat. So let us understand about geographical indication. What is that? So what intellectual property organization defines the geographical indication? What is that? It is basically a sign that has been used on the products, right, that has been originated from the particular geographical location or particular from the particular geographical origin, and that particular geographical location have possessing a special qualities or the reputation, right, that are due to a unique characteristic of that particular, you know, a variety of crop. So it's a very, very important. It can be typically used for agriculture products, for foodstuffs, for handicrafts, for agricultural products, for wines, for spray drinks that have been unique geographical origin, geographical location, that is vested with the unique qualities, with the unique aspect. Okay, so internationally this geographical indication are covered as an element of intellectual property right, or that we call basically the IPR. So they are covered under IPR design under the Paris Convention on the Protection of the Industrial Property. So it's a very, very important. They have also covered under the trade related aspects of the intellectual property right. They are also known as TRIPS. So they have been covered under intellectual property rights. So it's a very, very important aspect with that respect. Okay, so it is a Valia wheat. It's a very good, you know, which have been exported recently. Next, the authorized economic operators. So here the news is the Central Board of Indirect Taxes and the Customs, CBIC, have inaugurated the online filling of authorized economic operators, right, that is T2 and T3 applications. Okay, now what is that, the online economic operators? So this authorized economic operators is one of the main building block within, you know, the World Custom Organization, right, under the SAFE framework of the standard, that is the SAFE. So the SAFE is a part of the future international customs model that has been set out for the support to secure the trade from across the world. So the growth of the global trade and increasing the security threats to the international movements of the goods through this, the SAFE framework of the standards is one of the important aspects. Okay, and that have forced the custom administration to shift their focus more and more to securing the international trade flow, that is away from the traditional task of collecting the customs duty. So recognizing this development, the World Custom Organization, right, drafted this World Custom Organization SAFE framework standard, okay, right, to secure and to facilitate the global trade, right, all along the world in terms of your goods and services. So in this framework, several standards are included which can assist, you know, the custom officials or the custom administrators in meeting the new challenges all across the world. Okay, so developing an authorized economic operators is a core part of this, the SAFE framework of the standard, for the purpose of, you know, securing and facilitating the global trade all across the world. This is the most important aspect. So what is about, you know, about this, you know, authorized economic operators in India? So authorized economic operators in India basically is a voluntary program which basically enable, you know, the Indian customs or the officials to enhance and streamline the cargo security, right? How would this streamline the cargo security, right, through the close cooperation with the principal stakeholders? You can say that, you know, who are these principal stakeholders? Like you have the importers, you know, exporters, the logistic providers, the custodians, right? You have the terminal operators where all sort of goods have been, you know, exported and imported, the custom brokers, warehouse operators. So here to enhance this streamline, you know, the cargo security with the help of these stakeholders. Regarding World Customs Organization, the World Customs Organization is basically an intergovernmental organization which has been headquartered in the Brussels in the Belgium. Okay, and the World Customs Organization is noted for their work specifically in terms of the facilitation of the trade. So it basically works for the custom enforcement activities, combating some sort of a counterfeiting, you know, the in support of your intellectual property rights, drug enforcement through the movement of the goods, the illegal weapon trading through this, you know, this international trade, the integrity promotion, delivering of sustainable capacity building, right, definitely to assist some of the custom officials in terms of the modernization of these trade. So the World Custom Organization, right, is an intergovernmental organization which is currently represents around 179 custom administrations, right, that collectively possess around 98% of the world trade, 98% of the world trade, right? And you know, the World Custom Organization has a tool and expertise to assist the implementation of all legal, you know, issues, the policy issues, the policy aspects, the procedural aspect, the technological, the human resources aspects, right, related to the trade facilitation all across the world. So here the World Custom Organization also maintains the International Harmonized System, that is basically called HS, or International Harmonized System, right, which basically boots, you know, some sort of a nomenclature, or the administers the technical aspect of the World Trade Organization agreements on, you know, the customs valuation origin and origin of your the rules for that purpose. So it's a very important organization with that respect. Okay. Next, you have the waters war between Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. You might have seen that you have the federal dispute that is related to, right, the distribution and the uses of the water that has been flowed through the interstate water movement. So here the Krishna River water dispute is one of the most important dispute between the Andhra Pradesh and the Telangana. So recently, you know, ongoing the fight over the water resources, that is the Jala Jagadam, right, which have been noted or described by the regional media, a fight or the war between the Andhra Pradesh and the Telangana for the sharing of this water, right? It is related to the police, you know, the fight between Andhra Pradesh and the Telangana, where, you know, the police forces of the Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, they are at tense standoff at the borders over the release of the water from the Nagarjun Sagar reservoir on the Krishna River. Okay, and both of these states are basically having disagreement over the sharing of this Krishna River water to share the policies of this region. So the Andhra Pradesh basically, which is a most important, you know, riparian state, so Andhra Pradesh alleged that the Telangana had been drawing the water, right, from the Krishna water for the four projects, that four projects have been set up, right, you know, without approval from the Krishna River Water Management Board. These four projects which have been drawing the water from the Krishna River, which have been set up at Jurala, Sri Sailam, the Nagarjun Sagar, and the last is Puli Chintala, right? And the Andhra Pradesh is alleging that the Telangana is drawing this water without approval from the Krishna River Management Board that basically manages the water flows in the Krishna River, in that manner. So Krishna River Water Management Board is basically an autonomous body that have been set up, you know, after the bifurcation of the state. That state Andhra Pradesh was bifurcated into Andhra Pradesh and Telangana in 2014 to manage and to regulate the waters in the Krishna basin. So here the Andhra Pradesh is saying that to the Telangana, why don't you consult with this Krishna River Management Board and then draw the water without informing or without discussing with that, without approving from Krishna River Water Management Board, the activities which were done by the Telangana is illegal. Now, what is the real issue? That is the most important aspect, is that the water that has been used for the power generation, okay, Andhra Pradesh says that it has been totally wasted by releasing into the Bay of Bengal in the name of the power generation. Even the farmers in the Krishna Delta, right, you know, they are not getting the water, or they are yet to begin the Kharif crop, right? And Telangana says that, what the Telangana's, you know, the claim, Telangana says that it would continue with that hydropower generation to meet the requirement of the power, because in Telangana there is huge deficit of the water, huge deficit of the power. Okay, at the same time, you know, it has the strong exception to the irrigation project which was started by the Andhra Pradesh government, especially, you know, the Andhra Pradesh which was started, right, the Rayalaseema, the lift irrigation project which the Telangana considered as a illegal project, because the Telangana again claimed that it has not consulted or it has not taken the approval from the Krishna River Water Management Board. And the Telangana also calling for the 50-50% allocation of the water from the Krishna River, but the Andhra Pradesh is not in the favor of 50% or 50-50% split of this Krishna River water. Okay, and the Telangana is basically pushing for the big Heidel projects specifically for the power generation. So this Kalisham lift irrigation project, which was inaugurated in 2019, which basically required a huge amount of water in order to produce this hydroelectric power from the Godavari River. Okay, now it's a very important, the Telangana government says that it needs this hydroelectric energy, right, to power its, you know, several lift irrigation projects, right, that have been started. For example, the Nitim Pedu, the Bhima lift irrigation projects, the Koil Sagar lift irrigation project, the Kawalpatti lift irrigation projects, all lift irrigation projects basically require the water. Despite of having the protest from the Andhra Pradesh, the Telangana CM or the Chief Minister of the Telangana have chosen to operate all hydroelectric projects, and operating of all hydroelectric projects basically require the huge amount of water that have been burdened, you know, the Andhra Pradesh with that respect. Okay, and what the Telangana want? The Telangana want the Krishna Water Dispute Tribunal to permanently settle this water dispute. It's a very very important. Okay, it's very very important. And you know, in the meantime, the Telangana also want this, you know, this board to convene a full-fledged board meeting on the mutually agreed date to this month to address the grievances against the Andhra Pradesh with that respect. Okay. Next, the West Bengal to set up the Legislative Council. Legislative Council is considered as an upper house of the state legislature. Okay, so you know, the West Bengal Legislative Assembly have passed a resolution for the Legislative Council by special majority, that is the 2/3 majority of the members of the house. Okay, so once this special majority resolution is passed, you know, it has empowered the parliament to create the state legislative council in the state of West Bengal. That is how the constitution basically requires. So what is the state legislative council? It's an upper house. You can also say that in the Hindi, that is Vidhan Parishad. It is also known as in the Hindi Vidhan Parishad. The Vidhan Sabha is basically the state legislative assembly. The Vidhan Parishad is basically the state legislative council. It's an upper house, right, in the state legislature. Wherever you have the bicameral state legislature, bicameral means the two houses, right? You know, you have currently the 28 states in our country. Out of 28 states, only the 6 states are having the bicameral legislature. The 6 states are basically Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, okay, Telangana, Maharashtra, Bihar and UP, Uttar Pradesh. Okay, and once the state legislative council created the West Bengal, the West Bengal will also be the 7th such state for that purpose. Now what is the use of, or what is the need of other house? So here best important aspect is that it has various functions in the federal setup, right? It represents the people, right? To it basically checks the hasty legislation which have been passed by the state legislative assembly. It scrutinizes the executive government, right? It basically checks, or it imposes the executive responsibility and accountability also. So regarding the creation and the abolition of the legislative council, that has been governed by Article 169 of our constitution. So parliament has power to create or to abolish the state legislative council, right, once it passes a resolution for that respect. So parliament will be empowered to basically create that type of state legislative council in that particular state. Okay, so that is all about the West Bengal. The Mamata Banerjee led government is basically ruling the current West Bengal, or current, you know, government in the West Bengal. Next is basically the nitrogen dioxide pollution went up to 125%. So the first time, you know, the Delhi recorded the increase of around 125% of the nitrogen dioxide, that is NO2 pollution, that has been analyzed between April 2020 and April 2021, according to the Green Pace India study that has been conducted, which analyzed the nitrogen dioxide concentration in India's 8 most populous state capitals. These 8 most populous state capitals are basically, first of all, Mumbai, Delhi, Bangalore, Hyderabad, Chennai, Kolkata, Jaipur and Lucknow, right? These are the 8 most populous state capitals where there have been found the dramatic increase during the period between April 2020 and April 2021. So Delhi has seen the most dramatic increase among all those state capitals. And the nitrogen dioxide is basically a very dangerous air pollutant, okay, and which has been released when the fuel is burned, as you know that, right, specifically in the motor vehicles, in the power generation, in the coal-based power generation plant, in the industrial process. And the exposure of this nitrogen dioxide can severely impact the health or the human health, right, at all the ages, irrespective of the ages. It is affecting, you know, respiratory system, the circulatory system. It has also affect the brain functioning, right, which has lead to, you know, early mortality or premature mortality. It also increases hospitalization expenses. Okay, the satellite observation reveals this nitrogen dioxide pollution has increased to around 125%, right, of the April 2020 levels. So this analysis, you know, suggests the increase would have been even greater than 146%, okay, and had the weather conditions been similar to 2020, but thanks to the weather conditions, this have not been reported to that level. Okay, you know, although relatively better than, you know, the capitals, the Indian cities too recorded an early worrying increase of the nitrogen dioxide train, or the rise in nitrogen dioxide train. Okay, for example, if you see in the Mumbai specifically, the nitrogen dioxide increased by around 52%. Okay, in the Bengaluru, it has been increased by, you know, around 90%. In the Hyderabad, it has been increased by around 69%. In Chennai, it has been increased by around 94%. Okay, if you see in Kolkata, it has been increased by around 11%. If you see in Jaipur, it has been increased by around 47%, and in Lucknow, it has been increased by around, you know, 32%. So this is the worrisome trend in terms of the rise in nitrogen dioxide pollution. Next, you have the sun caused a radio blackout. So what is that radio blackout? So as you know, that sun emitted the large solar flares, right, that have been observed by NASA or National Administration, National Aeronautics Space Administration, that is the premier, the USA's space agency, Solar Dynamics Observatory, right. These solar flares have been observed. These solar flares are nothing but the magnetic storms that have been launched from the surface of the Earth, and that releases the energy that is equivalent to the few million hydrogen bombs that have been exploding at the same time, right, and which have been known for this radio blackout. Okay, so here, during the solar flare, you know, this very high energy charge particles, they have been expelled from the surface of the sun, which is closer to the speed of light, and that have been entered into the surface or in the atmosphere of the Earth, right. These rays can disturb the ionosphere, which is basically the topmost layer of our, you know, of our atmosphere of the Earth, and which is very, very important for the radio communication from these all sort of radio communication waves, basically, reflected back to the surface. So when disturb this ionosphere, when interacting with these ions, free particles which have been found over there, these charged particles can disturb this ionospheric region. So this US Space Weather Prediction Center have said this, the strong radio blackout occurred in the certain regions, specifically in the Atlantic region, because of the disturbance in the ionospheric layer, right. So when this radiation or this energetic particles or this solar flare or solar plasma materials released, you know, they interact with the Earth magnetosphere or this ionospheric region, okay, and it creates some sort of a geomagnetic storm, right, after interacting with the ionospheric region. So this geomagnetic storm causes this radio blackout, and this induces the strong currents at the ground level, which can trip the electric power grids, right, in the countries also, so which are basically located at the higher latitudes because of these geomagnetic storms. So biggest impact of the solar flares, it has been recorded in the northern power grid failing, or the northern American power grid failing because of this geomagnetic storm, right. You can say that, you know, in the Canada, specifically in the Quebec, right, a power blackout was basically observed for almost 12 hours, and the radio signals are basically jammed due to this geomagnetic storm or due to this solar flare. So this can impact only at the higher latitude and region, right, where this solar flares or the charge, the plasma material from the sun interacting with the ionospheric region and causing some sort of a geomagnetic storm and jamming the radio functioning or the radio wave function. It can also, affect your grid functioning of the electricity with that aspect. Okay. Next, the government brings the Department of Public Enterprises under the Ministry of Finance, right? That government step was basically to facilitate the ambitious disinvestment program. And the earlier, the Department of Public Enterprises was basically with the Ministry of Heavy Industries and the Public Enterprises. But the government is eyeing on the disinvestment program. With that purpose, it has been brought under the Ministry of Finance. The Ministry of Finance, the following subheading, right? That is the Department of Public Enterprises, as per the Cabinet Secretariat notification, which has been brought under the Ministry of Finance. Now, that gazette notification that we are talking, that says about the rules that may be called for the Government of India's allocation of the business, that is 361st Amendment Rules 2021 regarding the allocation of the rules, right? And that shall come into the force once, right? And with that addition, the sixth department under the Ministry of Finance comes as a Department of Public Enterprises. Okay. And if you remember, in the budget 2021-22, when the Nirmala Sitharaman was basically announcing the budget speech, in that budget speech, the Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman also announced a big ticket privatization agenda. Okay, that include the privatization of the two public sector banks and one general insurance company in that respect. So, apart from this disinvestment strategy for financial sector, the government has also decided to initiate some sort of an initial public offering of the Life Insurance Corporation of India, right? So here the government has budgeted around 1.75 lakh crore rupees, right? That has been stake sale from the public sector companies as well as the financial institutions from in the year of 2021-2022, right, due to the disinvestment target. And for that purpose, to streamline that one, the Department of Public Enterprises has been brought under the Ministry of Finance. So that's all for today. Thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you.